he should have moved out, or why were there weapons in the Darbar Sahib? This is utter nonsense. These are the things which are manufactured and disseminated by the government to create chaos within the community, essentially. So you and I are busy discussing unessential things, and we forget about what really happened. And that's sort of, that's the objective today. So I'm going to cite you things which we'll talk more about, or reference them rather, for you. So even if you already are aware of it, this is basically an ammunition for you to go convince your community members first, and then work with people who are trying to do deliver justice regarding these kinds of issues. So the idea is to be very informed of what happened from a Sikh perspective. And I'll start with that. Here's the outline of what we're going to do. We'll talk about this thing about what is this Operation Blue Star? What are the facts we know a little bit? Then independent sources on how they witnessed this carnage, what the studies they conducted, some pictorial evidence to counter government claims, the debate within the Indian Army, some estimate of the casualty figures, and the inhumane actions which were conducted by the machinery of the state, and then some conclusions. Here's the first thing. I know it's not acceptable to label what happened in 84 as genocide, but I want you to be familiar with what is genocide according to UN conventions. And if you look at the definitions, it essentially is saying, actually we meet the criteria of the first three bullets, which basically is saying that if you target a specific member of a community in some sort of a systematic way with an intent to eliminate them or destruction, then this is a genocide. Now I want you to know the politics of genocide. The politics of genocide is that countries don't declare certain carnages or massacres as genocides, because if they declare it to be genocide, then it's their moral duty to go intervene. And this is where India, being one of the superpowers, they don't like to go declare things genocide. Like what happened last year. There's only, essentially, when US declared that Darfur is a genocide, US sent troops there to intervene. Most of the countries in Europe, in fact throughout the world, are still not declaring it a genocide, because if they say it's a genocide, they have to go and stop it. So that's the politics behind it, or the legal framework behind it. But if you look at it in terms of intent, in terms of the atrocities, in terms of even the legal ramifications, it essentially is a genocide. And I want you to start using those words. You know, carnage is not as big. When you hear the term genocide, it sounds big also, because it was big. It's not just a small massacre. There are massacres occurring several times in a year in several countries. But genocide, in the Sikh tradition, is a Kalhukara word. Kalhukara is when the state of the time declares complete intention for complete destruction of a community. And this has happened several times in our history. It happened during the Mughal Empire. I was mentioning it yesterday a bit. It happened, in fact, in 1700s, there were six separate events to do that. Two of them are major events, and we call them Chota Kalhukara and Mota Kalhukara. In the last 20 years, there were at least three events, in 84 of June and in November, and then the series of operations by the government to kill Sikhs. And all these are part of the Kalhukara tradition, which basically means that state is going to, at all costs, is after the nation, is after the culture, it's after your artifacts, it's after everything which makes you independent of a sovereign people. And that's exactly what they did. Let's look at some of the facts. The government at the time had very clearly articulated that if these things won't happen by then, on 3rd of June, they're going to create a civil disobedience protest. The government knew this, and they knew that they're, again, not a violent movement, a civil disobedience. It basically means that you're going to articulate your grievances against the government. So they knew the Sikhs were about to do this, so, and they were preparing for it, and they started the attack before that. Now, if you've been in India in the month of June, and you have walked on the Parikrama, even with that kind of a climate, thousands of people still show up. So it wasn't just like a big commemoration day where lots of people show up. You have to take it from an angle that not only is the whole complex filled, even the Parikrama is full. People are going in and out with a hope that they are able to remember what Guru Arjan Sahib did in that complex. So there were a lot of people who had come there, not just to worship, but also to commemorate the martyrdom day. And this, several of the people were going to spend nights, not just in the rest areas which are available to us through SGPC and other systems, but also a lot of them sleep in the Prakarma. It's very common, which they knew. Again, this is to establish that they knew that a lot of people were going to be there, and they wanted to kill them, kill as many as possible. That's why they chose that day. And this is very important. There was no opportunity for anyone to leave. Even if you follow the conventions of war, there's always an opportunity that if there are people who don't want to participate, they should leave. And I'll bring this point home later, because the militants always gave opportunities to leave. There was no disruption by them. The disruption was by the government of India, where they did not allow the pilgrims to leave. The Yatri IOC, the employees of the SGPC, and the civilians who were there, none of them were given the opportunity. Let's look at a couple of other things. You know, the whole premise government used was that we are going inside the Darwaza complex, or Golden Temple, as they use the word in their white paper. We are going in there to seize the terrorists. That's the line they used. Well, if they were going here to seize them, I would present a Sikh perspective. We look at the evidence of this. They actually went in there to terrorize the Sikhs. If you are going to go capture some of the militants, are you going to use chemical gas against your own citizens? Are you going to take the tents inside the most, what the historians have called the Jerusalem of the Sikhs, or the Mecca of the Sikhs, or the St. Petersburg of the Sikhs? So this isn't a small operation. The idea here and the intent here is, chemical gas, what is the purpose? It does not differentiate who is there. So the idea is to kill all. And that's exactly what they use. And we'll look at the number of divisions they use. 9 infantry divisions. Infantry is people who fight at the front lines. So if you're taking 9 divisions, how many people are you going there to capture? You have to think about the numbers here. So essentially, their target is not to capture people, it's again to kill. Estimates vary from 70,000 to 150,000. This is the number of soldiers used by the government of India to go inside the Golden Temple complex. Now, if government and the parliament admitted that they went inside the complex to capture 38 individuals, how many people do you need to capture 38? First of all, they admitted even later in the parliament, in Indian parliament, that of those 38 people, most of them were not even in the country. So it's just a fabrication of lots of lies. And how are these lies becoming prevalent? Because you have to remember, at the time, the state media controls all the information. Newspapers are towing the government line. The radios and the televisions are... There are no free TV stations or radio stations, so they're all governments. So whatever the statement from government comes, that's what they say. In fact, you know, including the Darwarsab's head, Granthi, at the time, because they put a gun to his head, he also said on TV. He said nothing has, no destruction has occurred in Darwarsab. Of course he lied, Yani Saab said. An explanation is because he had a gun to his head. My point is, this is what was going on. They were all speaking what the government wanted them to speak. And these things I'm going to elaborate in quite detail in the next slides. So let's start with that. I don't know how many of you are familiar with this, but in India there are several intelligence agencies as well. The most common ones are IB. Some of you maybe have heard of RAW, which is Research and Analysis Wing. But there's a third one, which nobody knows the name for it. It's also always referred to as the third agency. And in fact, you can. This was printed in the Surya magazine, which was obviously... since 84, they haven't been able to publish anything because they published this kind of information. So government stopped their publication. They said the analysis of the third agency, which is essentially an intelligence agency of the government of India, that the reason they were doing this was to capture the Hindu vote in India. Because the sentiment, the will, the political will in India was that something needs to be done to the Sikhs. So this was the analysis of Indian intelligence agency. Second, they also wanted to prove to the opposition being the non-Congress parties, that they can handle the so-called terrorists in Punjab. So they wanted to show them that we are capable of dealing with these things. And the third is, they were also building an alternative in intelligence by showing that RAW and IB are ineffective. Now, this is some serious business, guys. This is the kind of stuff which, of course, none of the TVs or the newspapers will write about. So what this is saying is that there is an intelligence agency of the government